Have you ever been browsing the internet and run into a complete train of alphabet soup titles after an engineer's name? Or see it on someone's email signature or business card?
New card. What do you think?
Welcome to the channel. My name is Byron, and I'm a traffic engineer in California, USA. When it comes to the licenses and certifications of transportation and traffic engineers, there are many that are available. And because of that, we can't have a lot of them listed after our name. I'll admit, sometimes it looks like we are getting carried away, but what is the significance and what do they all mean? Is it some kind of contest to see who could have the most titles? Or is there some inner need to gotta collect them all?
It took me a couple of years to collect them all.
No matter the intent, chances are most people don't know what all these titles mean. In this video, I'm going to talk about the most common ones you may see and what they signify. If you are an engineer, you're going to have a better understanding of all the licenses and certifications that are available to you so that you can level up. If you're not an engineer, you'll get to see a little bit about the process and requirements for engineers to get these titles and what they could mean. And to make this a little fun, I'm going to count how many times I say an acronym in this video, because I'm going to be saying a lot. Let's get started. The first one I would talk about is actually the first certification I obtained. The EIT or EI certification stands for the Engineering in Training or Engineering Intern Certification. In the USA, engineers can be licensed, but before you do that, you have to show that you understand a base level of knowledge and engineering principles. Those who obtain this EIT certification has taken the first step in a multi-step process to becoming a licensed engineer. Obtaining the EIT certification requires passing an exam. This exam is the Fundamentals of Engineering exam, or the FE exam. The purpose of this 110-question, 5-hour exam is to test someone's knowledge of basic engineering principles, which you're expected to learn in a typical 4-year degree of engineering. What are some of the topics in this exam? Some example topics in this exam include mathematics, surveying, physics, and engineering economics, but also specialized courses like water resources, transportation, geotechnical, structural, some of the civil engineering topics that you're expected to learn. And just like the name says, if someone gets the engineering in training or engineering intern certification, which they're practically the same, it means they are training to become a professionally licensed civil engineer in the future. And not everyone can try for this certification. You have to meet certain requirements, which is often 3 years of engineering-related work experience or 3 years of engineering-related college post-secondary education. Specific requirements can vary between different states. What can you expect with someone who has this title? Someone who's EIT and EI certified has passed the FE exam and has a foundation of fundamental engineering knowledge and principles. They're most likely working under a professional engineer so they can get the work experience to take the next step, which is to become a fully licensed civil engineer. So they are not a professionally licensed engineer yet. Next up, we have the PE title, which is commonly known as the Professional Engineer's License. When you see this after someone's name, it means that they're a professionally licensed engineer. In order to get this license, there are some key steps that they had to take. The first is that they had to get their EIT or EI certification, which is what I talked about earlier in this video. But after they get their EIT certification, they also have to show that they have a minimum amount of work experience. And that work experience is typically 3 to 4 years, but it also needs to be under the supervision of a professionally licensed engineer. And once someone has all that, then they can apply to take the Principles and Practices of Engineering exam, or the PE exam. PE exam is a long exam with 80 questions over 8 hours, testing the knowledge of what a professionally licensed engineer is expected to know. Only after all these steps are completed can one obtain their PE license. The actual license is administered by the state, and the license holder will then have the ability to practice professional engineering in that state. Note that some states have additional requirements or exams that a license holder will need to complete. For example, here in California, I needed to take 2 additional exams, one for seismic and one for surveying, to get my PE license. Each exam was 2.5 hours long. How the EIT and PE react is, once someone gets their PE, they do not need to show that they have an EIT anymore, because the PE supersedes the EIT. What can you expect with someone who has a PE designation in their name? Someone who has a PE in their name has likely fulfilled the requirements to become a licensed engineer. The most common path is to have 4 years in an engineering degree and also 4 years of working experience. And they've also passed the PE exam, which shows that they have minimum level of competency to practice civil engineering. PE license grants the license holder the ability to practice engineering in the state that they got the license in, so they can certify or stamp engineering plans or documents. Getting the civil PE is a big achievement for a civil engineer and opens many doors in the industry. The next one I'm going to talk about is a rare one, because most engineers don't have the opportunity to take this exam. Sometimes you'll see someone with a TE after their name. That stands for a traffic engineer's license. The reason why I said it's rare is because it's actually only offered in one state, California. Turns out, California as a state created and administered their own traffic engineer license exam. So if someone has it, it means they've earned the ability to display their name as a professional traffic engineer or officially advertise their service as professional traffic engineer. It's one designation that I prioritized after I got my PE license because I am a traffic engineer, so it made sense to get my traffic engineer's license too. How does this relate to having a PE license? Well, it doesn't. You could have a PE, a TE, or both. Similar to getting a PE license, to get a TE, you also have to show that you meet the minimum requirements and work experience. You also have to pass a TE exam. The TE exam test is similar to a PE exam, being 8 hours long, but it is all focused on traffic engineering. So what can you expect with someone who has a TE license? Someone who has a TE after their name has met the requirements to become a licensed traffic engineer in the state of California. They have worked and gained at least 4 years of traffic engineering experience, and they've also passed the 8-hour TE exam administered by the state. TE license in California falls under the Title Act, which means it allows someone to display their title as a licensed traffic engineer. This is unlike the PE, which is under a Practice Act, because a PE can stamp and certify plans, while a TE does not have that additional power. One may wonder, well then what's the point of getting it?
What's the point?
I will say that it's still useful to have because having a TE, people still recognize that you have specialized knowledge in traffic engineering. It's a license that's backed by the state, but I'm also seeing it mentioned more in job postings, especially government job postings. So now that we talked about the state licenses and certifications, let's talk about some other certifications that are from other organizations. One that you may see some transportation engineers have is the PTOE, or the Professional Traffic Operations Engineer Certification. It is administered by the TPCB, or the Transportation Professional Certification Board. The TPCB is an independent nonprofit organization and is supported by funds from the Federal Highway Administration, or FHWA. You may not have heard of the TPCB, but you may have heard of another organization called ITE, or Institute of Transportation Engineers. ITE provides support for TPCB, and if you ever hear of the PTOE, it's probably from an ITE publication or an ITE member who has the PTOE. The TPCB is a credible organization, and the PTOE is available for already professionally licensed engineers in the USA or Canada who wants to take their knowledge to the next level. In order to get this certification, an applicant has to pass a 6-hour exam on many topics of traffic operations, including road safety, marking and signage, and traffic flow principles. What can you expect with someone who has a PTOE designation? To me, this has a lot of overlap with the traffic engineer's license in California. Although that was a more comprehensive exam, the PTOE kind of serves a similar purpose and a lot of the topics overlap. So to me, I've always seen the PTOE certification as kind of like the TE, but for other states that don't offer an actual TE license. Although there are some major differences from a state-backed license like the TE versus the PTOE, which is a certification offered by an independent organization. Having a PTOE shows that an engineer has taken steps to definitely broaden their knowledge and deepen it in professional traffic operations engineering related topics. And also, in order to maintain this certification, the TPCB requires that certification holders take 45 hours of professional development every 3 years. So the last certification that I'm going to talk about is an interesting one because it's the new kid on the block. You may see some professionals have the RSP designation, which stands for the Road Safety Professional Certification. Because road safety has been a big focus here in the US and Canada in the past decade, the RSP certifications were made available for those professionals who want to deepen their understanding in road safety topics. Emerging and specialized topics like Vision Zero, human behavioral factors, and implementing safety programs are examples of topics that are included in RSP examinations. What further separates the RSP designation from other certifications that I've seen is that there are actually two levels to the certification. RSP 1 is the first level and focuses on the foundation of the current safety practices. In order to get the RSP 1 certification, one has to pass the RSP 1 exam. The RSP 2 certification is focused on developing and implementing engineering or behavioral programs that are designed to reduce fatal or serious injury crashes on the road. Therefore, there are actually two different RSP2 exams you can choose from. One that's focused on infrastructure and the other that's focused on behavioral. So when one gets an RSP2 certification, it is understood as an RSP2 with an infrastructure specialty or an RSP2 with a behavioral specialty. If you see someone with any of these RSP certifications, it means they spent the extra time to learn and understand specialized road safety design and practice. Just like the PTOE, in order to maintain an RSP certification, a road safety professional will need to pursue continued learning. An RSP1 certification requires 24 hours over a 3-year period, while an RSP2 certification requires 45 hours. Furthermore, if you want to get the RSP1 certification in Saudi Arabia or one of the other Gulf countries, the TBCB offers a version of the RSP1, but it is named the RSPSA. Created in 2021, the RSPA was designed to meet the standards of the RSP1 certification, but also be sensitive to some of the practices in the Gulf countries. What can you expect with someone who has any of these types of RSP certifications? A professional with any of these RSP certifications will have the deepened knowledge of road safety principles and practices and have passed the appropriate exam to get the certification. Not only have they shown that they know this knowledge, they are also up to date with emerging trends because of the requirement to continually learn and fulfill professional development hours to maintain the certification. So that was a quick overview of the many titles that you may see that are associated with transportation engineers. I hope this helps in understanding the additional knowledge an engineer has pursued if you see one of these licenses or certifications after an engineer's name. And if you're an engineer, these licenses and certifications are a great opportunity for you to expand your knowledge and expertise. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you'd like to see more content like this in the future. Thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.